We hear a lot about the problems in the world of buildings and the built environment, but why is now such an exciting time to be talking about the solutions?
Well, first of all, because both society and the planet actually face now challenges that we have never seen before. We are facing environmental challenges. Who can deny the crisis there? But we're also speaking about challenges and crises on a societal level and on an economic level. And all these are related with everything that surrounds us, and they are related with the spaces that we inhabit. They are, of course, related with the way that we're building and the way that we are inhabiting. So at the same time, besides the challenges, we're also living at a kind of an amazing digital revolution. As humans, as designers, we are shifting between the physical and the digital like hundreds times per day. And the digital becomes every time closer to the people, so it starts to be democratized through the internet, through the communities that they can share the tools, which also means that this digital revolution is starting to become a tool for giving certain solutions to our built space and our architecture. Our built environment is not responding to our needs because our needs are changing continuously. And we also need to expect more from architecture. We need to ask more from architecture, and we need to ask more from architects. Until today, we are mainly producing architecture that is consuming. It's consuming energy, resources, materials. And it gives very little back if we think about it in a more holistic way. It actually gives back a shelter, but it gives nothing to the environment, it gives nothing to the community, it gives nothing to issues related with economy, for instance. So understanding that our artifacts, our built environment, is something more dynamic, it also changes the way that we deal with it. Nature has been very wise in creating every shelter as if it was a living organism. You know, it is a living organism. And we humans are the only ones that were creating shelters that they are not alive, or they are not following, let's say, natural principles, and they are not reacting into anything that surrounds it. On the contrary, they are really enclosed into everything that surrounds it. So if we ask more from architecture, if we ask that architecture is able to adapt, to change shape, is able to integrate principles or actions, same as biological organisms do, for example, filter air, produce energy, produce resources, you know, like, then we would have a radically different image of what architecture is and how we can interact with it.
So architecture has a fundamental role to play in reshaping the future, and there's a call from it from the time we're living in, and there's an opportunity to exploit it because of the new technologies that we have at our disposal. You mentioned earlier about the idea that we currently design and build buildings and also think of buildings from a mindset perspective as being purely shelter. They just cover our cover us at night, and we live in them or operate in them. What else can buildings do, though, someone might ask?
Oh, a lot of things.
I will ask.
A lot of things. They can produce resources. First of all, they can produce resources such as energy or such as food. You know, there are a lot of buildings today that we can see that they have renewable energy technologies on it, such as photovoltaic panels or urban windmills and geothermal systems of generating energy. We back in Barcelona were also working on alternatives in how we can use, for instance, expertise from other disciplines to bring back to architecture in order to create a more productive sense of it. So, for instance, we're working with biophotovoltaic technologies, technologies that they are using the photosynthetic activity of a plant in order to generate energy, because we are able to capture the microbial organisms of the roots of the plants and generate energy through greening space, through not any necessarily plugged in systems of, for example, photovoltaic panels. So
can you break that down for us just a tiny bit more? So photovoltaic panels there, you've got the solar panels, which is just, you know, we put those on our roofs that generate solar energy. I think most people are sort of, that's like quite a well-known concept. And now we've got biophotovoltaic. And so what is this doing exactly?
This is doing a lot of things. So first of all, it's growing plants. It's growing green. It could be plants, it could be vegetables, it could be a lot of things that we want to plant there. Second of all, it's generating energy. So if we imagine the big amount of open space that we have in our cities, you know,
like it could be in our parks,
in a park, in public spaces, in highways, in terraces of the buildings, in facades of the buildings, we have so many square meters of rigid materials that they could potentially be something else. So they could be greened. They could create a kind of a higher aesthetic in terms of seeing an asphalt or a concrete material. Seeing green is always, of course, better. But at the same time, plants can filter air because they absorb CO2. So, you know, you have an added value into greening spaces. They can also protect, for instance, from urban flooding. There are a lot of cities, contemporary cities today, that they have big issue on flooding. So having green areas that they can do multiple functions, it's really an amazing idea and a very simple one, right? So
this is generating energy.
Added to that, we're generating energy that it could eventually, you know, power, for example, the lighting, the street lighting that we need. The energy that you can generate from a biophotovoltaic technology is still very much in its initial, let's say, steps. It's not very high, but you can optimize it, and you can also use it according to, you know, like combining with technologies of LED lighting that needs very little voltage there, etc.
So is this energy positive? Would we call that a net energy positive technology in the sense that it's producing more energy than it would use?
It definitely...
This is a technology that's sort of testing phase, I guess.
That's correct. We are building new buildings like every day. We will be needing around 100,000 homes daily in the next 20 years. So rethinking how all those systems can be integrated into the new buildings that we will be producing is also fundamental. Facades that they can have all those systems implemented into that, you know, like green roofs, biomass stations that could be integrated into the basements rather than parking, because, you know, car will disappear as a kind of a private object. And this opens up the possibility of rethinking the typology of the building, but more than anything, as said before, rethinking the performance of it.
I want to talk a little bit about technology, because in your opening you described it as one of the key, you know, things that's making that now we have this opportunity because of technology. What do you mean by that, and what kinds of technologies are we talking about there?
Wow, that's a question that it could take us like 3 documentaries.
Let's try and do it in 2 minutes.
Okay, that's a silence. Well, there are different technologies that they can be used for producing a positive change into the building industry. First of all, technologies that they are related with manufacturing. So how do we manufacture? This is a prototype, actually, it's a bit heavy. This is a prototype that we have been taking advantage on technologies of 3D printing.
So that is 3D printed?
That is a 3D printed 100% natural material prototype. And this is small, but we also went big.
That's bigger.
Like some months ago. And what we have been trying to do here is to try to combine technologies of 3D printing. 3D printing is a revolutionary technique, because it actually allows you to deposit material only where you need it. That means that we can create structures that they don't have any excessive material on it. And that is a big let's say, positive impact in both environmental and economic issues. So we can also create much more complex forms without the necessity of any molds. So no waste here. We just have the raw material, which in that case, it's also 100% natural. It's pure earth with water-based additives. It's clay, it's unbaked, which also makes that recyclable, which means that you can, once you build something that after a few years you don't need anymore for several reasons, you can recycle the material, either bring it back to earth or reuse it to build something new. And this is something that we could never imagine that we could do before without those technologies. So,
and just to clarify, so that's unbaked clay, and that is even more unbaked clay. Why is it harder to make a building out of that without 3D printing than with 3D printing?
What you can do with 3D printing is that you can add properties that you cannot do without 3D printing. For instance, well, this is actually a good prototype to explain that. For instance, here you can see like a very complex organic form, you know, like it
There's
is really...
There's lots of layers inside there, right?
A lot of layers and a lot of different customized designs within that. In order to do something like that without 3D printing, you need a million of different molds. And you also need much more time than we need today. So what this is allowing us is that on the one hand, we are actually optimizing the material. So all these holes are also because of structural performance. But at the same time, all these openings are being designed based on environmental parameters for passive heating and passive cooling, so for ventilation to happen according to orientation, etc. So when we are 3D printing, we can also design so that we can enhance performance, so that we can enhance passive performance. And this is, again, something that we were not able to achieve until now without that technology.
It's a bit of a specific point, but I can imagine some people watching this at home will be wondering, why has, this is a wall, right? Why has it got holes in it? Because that's not how we normally design walls. What's the advantage of having holes in your walls?
Well, it depends on what kind of climate you are.
The UK, you probably wouldn't.
It depends also on which kind of orientation you are and exactly on what kind of site you are. But holes are for, as I said, ventilation, but also for lighting, according to orientation, for ventilation. And sometimes, especially when we're working with the clay, it's also helping the process of manufacturing so that the material can dry faster so that you can produce faster. And this is, again, connected with what I was saying in the beginning, the fact that we will need to find solutions not only for more sustainable, but also for quicker production of built environment. It makes it really important to start, you know, like optimize also the process of manufacturing.
So we need buildings that are better with energy, that produce things like energy and food for us. We need buildings that are, we obviously don't want buildings that are more expensive to make. Another architect was on the diff earlier in the second week, and he made the point that we have all the tools and technologies to do what we need to do in the built environment. But he had this frustration that it just wasn't happening. Is there a holdback with any of these technologies, or can you pretty much do this at scale if you had the right funding or et cetera, et cetera?
We are all frustrated. I share with him the frustration. And the frustration comes mainly by the fact that the construction sector is very slow. So research is very, very quick compared to the industry and compared to the to the norms related with the construction. No? In order to certify a material, it could take you like a lot of years. In order for a regulation to change, it could take you a lot of years. So we do have the technology, and there is every time more and more research and pilot projects that help us evaluate those technologies in real scales. And what we actually need is a kind of a more dynamic, process of regulating the construction and for adapting the regulation to the new inventions and innovation. This is something that is not always easy to achieve. You know, architecture will become more collaborative and technologies will help people to start understanding the process of architecture. Few months ago, well, no, actually that happened last year, we have created, I actually have it here. We have created, we brought from gaming industry principles of how we can create a game to engage people so that they can design their public space. So through playing, they were actually sharing their desires. But through multiplaying, they were also understanding what is the necessity of the rest of the community and also what is the impact of their design. So just greening a street doesn't necessarily mean that this is sustainable because it might need a lot of water or a lot of energy, etc. So rethinking the processes of design, allowing people to participate, engage people in a more technologically enhanced participatory design processes is the only way to create architecture that is closer to the needs of the people.